هنتكلم دلوقتي عن الفيمورال هيرنيا، وهنبدأ كلامنا عن السيرجيكال اناتومي اوف ذا فيمورال كانال. It occupies the most medial compartment of the femoral sheath, which is formed by the fascia transversalis anteriorly, fascia iliaca posteriorly, and is divided into three compartments by two perpendicular septa. The most medial compartment contains the femoral canal, which allows expansion of the femoral vein during increased venous return as a muscular exercise. The intermediate compartment contains the femoral vein. The most lateral compartment contains the femoral artery and femoral branch of the genitofemoral nerve. The femoral canal is cone-shaped with the base directed upward. It measures about half an inch, extends from the femoral ring to the saphenous opening. Here is a diagram of the femoral canal within the femoral sheath. Femoral ring. It contains fat, lymphatics, lymph nodes of Cloquet. It is covered by the femoral septum and has the following relations. Medially, the lacunar ligament or Gimbernat's ligament, which is the most medial part of the inguinal ligament, lower subtendinally, Bupart's ligament. Laterally, the femoral vein. Superiorly, inguinal ligament. Inferiorly, Cooper's ligament or pectineal reflection of the inguinal ligament. This thickened band running across the pectineal line of the pubis, incorporated in its periosteum, called the Ashley-Cooper's ligament, ilioinguinal ligament, or pectineal ligament. Pathology. The sac of the hernia passes downward through the femoral ring and femoral canal till its lower end, then passes forward, pushing cribriform fascia, then upwards towards the inguinal ligament. So this is the direction of descent. The neck of the sac is narrow, which increases the risk of reducibility and strangulation. Contents, omentum, intestine, etc. Richter's hernia is common. Sliding hernia also containing the urinary bladder may occur. Coverings, stretched femoral septum, transversalis fascia, cribriform fascia, subcutaneous tissue, and lastly, the skin, most superficial. Rare types of femoral hernia. The pre-vascular hernia or Narast hernia. It passes in front of the femoral artery. It has a wide sac, a wide sac neck. Strangulation is rare. It is easy to reduce but difficult to repair. May be associated with congenital hip dislocation. Second variety, pectineal hernia or Cloquet hernia. It passes behind the femoral vessels between the pectineous muscle and its fascia. Third type is external femoral hernia or Hasselbach's hernia. It passes lateral to the femoral artery. Lastly, lacunar hernia or hernia of Laguerre. It passes through the lacunar ligament of Gimbernat. Clinical picture 6. It occurs in females more than males with a percentage of 2 to 1. Why? Because the pelvis is wider in females with wider pubocranus and wider femoral ring. The femoral canal and its ring is wider also in female. The downward pelvic tilt in females allows easier descent of the hernia. Lastly, muscles, iliopsoas and pectineus, and the ligaments around are weaker. They normally encroach on the canal, thus act as a barrier against the development of hernia. Complaints. A young adult patient around 25 years age complaining of a lump in the groin which may cause dragging pain. It may present with strangulation for the first time. Clinical examination. A lump in the groin below and lateral to the pubic tubercle. It is reduced by pushing it downwards, backwards and then upwards. About 20% are bilateral. Here we come to the differences between the femoral hernia and inguinal hernia. Femoral hernia is commoner in females while inguinal hernia is commoner in males. Femoral hernia is lateral to the pubic tubercle and below the inguinal ligament, while inguinal hernia is medial to the pubic tubercle and above the inguinal ligament. The inguinal canal will be obviously empty in case of femoral hernia, while it is occupied by the hernia in case of inguinal one. After reduction of femoral hernia, closure of the femoral ring will prevent the hernia from coming down, while in inguinal hernia, it will come down when the patient cough. Deep ring test is negative in case of femoral hernia and it is positive in case of inguinal hernia. Reducibility is more likely in case of femoral hernia while it is less likely in case of inguinal hernia. Complications. Like any other hernia, but more commonly, the نتيجة للنارو نيك of the hernia, complications in the form of reducibility, it is 10 times more than inguinal hernia due to the narrow neck tortuous cores and adhesions within the sac. Strangulation is the second complication due to sharp edge of the lacunar ligament and narrow opening in fascia transversalis and upper sharp margin of the fossa ovalis. Treatment. Low approach or liquid operation. Incision. Overlying the swelling about 1 cm below and parallel to the inguinal ligament. Steps. The sac is dissected, transfixed and excised after reduction of the contents. The femoral canal is closed by suturing the pectineal ligament to the inguinal ligament. So it is Cooper's to Boebert's ligament repair. Disadvantages. The sac can't be completely excised from below and repair is difficult. Liability to injury of an abnormal obturator artery, which is the pubic branch of the inferior epigastric artery. If it is accompanied by an inguinal hernia, it will be very difficult or it is actually impossible to deal with it. Second approach is the inguinal approach of Lutsisen. Its incision as an inguinal hernia but a little lower in one of the creases. Steps, scarpus fascia and external oblique avenous are opened. Then the cord is elevated and the fascia transversalis is opened medial to inferior epigastric artery. The peritoneal sac is identified, isolated, is pulled upward into the inguinal canal, opened and transfixed after reduction of its contents and excised. Repair Cooper's ligament to Bober's ligament, and in addition, Bober's ligament is sutured also to the conjoint tendon. Disadvantage: as it is repaired under tension, it weakens the inguinal canal. The third approach is McAvity approach. Incision is vertical, made over the femoral canal and continued upwards above the inguinal ligament at the lateral border of rectus abdominis muscle. It is useful for dealing with cases complicated femoral hernia, complicated with irreducibility or strangulation. Steps: the anterior rectus sheath in its lower part is incised 2 centimeters medial to the linea subulinaris, and the rectus is displaced towards the midline. Then the fascia transversalis is divided to expose the peritoneum, and the hernial sac is identified and pulled up to be ligated and excised. Repair is done by one of the 2 previous methods. Disadvantage: if infected or if nerves to the rectus abdominis muscle are cut, it results in incisional hernia. Another approach is the posterior preperitoneal approach or Nias operation. Incision is horizontal, short, 3 fingers above the pubic tubercle. Steps: dissection is proceeded downward to the preperitoneal region. The hernia is reduced and the femoral canal is closed by suturing the idiopubic tract to the Cooper's ligament. Advantage: direct exposure without opening or weakening of the inguinal canal. The second is dissection through normal tissues and recurrent hernia instead of scar tissue. And if a sliding hernia is present, it can be dealt with directly. This is a diagram showing the 3 classic approaches for dealing with the femoral hernia. This is the high approach. Another method of dealing with femoral hernia is through Lichtenstein repair. Here is the patch overlying the whole myobectinial orifice, and here is the plug, which is fixed and sutured to the femoral canal. Next subject is umbilical hernia. By definition, it is hernia at and around the umbilicus. It is divided into 3 types: congenital umbilical hernia, infantile umbilical hernia, and adult or para-umbilical hernia. Congenital umbilical hernia presents in thrust due to failure of the midgut to return to the coelomic cavity in fetal life due to failure of the second stage of rotation. It is divided into aul no, eximphalus minor, in which there is a small defect persisting at the umbilicus through which a peritoneal sac protrudes through the umbilical cord. Contents: are loops of intestine or Meckel's diverticulum, which is known as literary hernia. Coverings, same layer for Artungeli and amniotic membrane. Complications, during ligation of the cord, a loop of the intestine may be entangled in the ligature, so always twist the cord to reduce the contents and ligate it 3 to 4 centimeters from the abdomen. Second complication is dislocation of the coverings and rupture of the hernia. Second type is Xanthophilus major, in which a large defect at or above the umbilicus, through which a large wide necked sac protrudes, contents large portion of the viscera, may be the left lobe of the liver. Coverings, a layer of amniotic membrane only. Complications, dislocation of the covering, rupture, and peritonitis. Treatment, an immediate operation is indicated. In small defects, Xanthophilus minor, contents are reduced, sac is excised, and abdominal muscles are approximated. In Xanthophilus major, create skin flaps by undermining of the skin, and release incisions are carried in the loin to cover the sac with skin without tension. Later, after a few years, repair of the hernia. A diagram to show the differences between Xanthophilus minor and major. In Xanthophilus minor, you can see here that the umbilical cord is attached at the center of the sac. In Xanthophilus major, the umbilical cord is attached below the sac. Second type of umbilical hernias is infantile umbilical hernia. Incidence, babies of both sexes. Causes, weak umbilical scar due to infection or distension. Second cause is increased intra-abdominal pressure due to crying, phimosis, cough, chronic bronchitis, and rickets. Pathology, sac is small, conical, white-necked, so the incidence of strangulation is low. Contents easily reducible, omentum or intestine. Coverings, stretched umbilical scar and extra peritoneal fat. Complications are rare since the sac has wide neck. Clinical picture. An umbilical swelling is increasing in size on crying and straining, reducible on lying down and sleeping. Examination reveals an expansile impulse on straining. The edges of the defect can be felt as a firm ring by the examining fingers. Treatment. First line of treatment is to remove the cause of straining. Second line is strapping, which is indicated if the child is less than 2 years, the defect is less than 2 fingers, and the hernia is reducible. The contents are reduced, the skin is raised in a vertical fold on either side of the middle line, and an adhesive plaster tapes are applied transversely to be changed every 2 weeks for 2 to 4 months, waiting for spontaneous closure of the defect. So the diagram show how to do strapping. operations. Indications: child over 2 years, defect over than 2 fingers, failed strapping, when the hernia is complicated. Technique: acrescentic sub-umbilical incision is done, dissecting the hernial sac, which is excised at the proper neck. The defect in the linear alba is repaired with few stitches. A subcutaneous drain is put and to be removed after 48 hours. A diagram to show the steps of the operation. The third type of umbilical hernia is the adult or para-umbilical hernia. Incidence: commonest in adult fatty multiparous females. Pathology: commoner above the umbilicus, as the linea alba being stretched from repeated pregnancy. Rare below, as the linea alba in this region is a thin line. Sac starts small, gradually enlarging, narrow-necked, multilocular. Fundus has frequent fundal adhesions. Contents: transverse colon, omentum, and small gut. Coverings: skin, subcutaneous fat, and extraperitoneal fat. Complications: reducibility and strangulation. They are common due to, in this type of hernia, it has a narrow neck, frequent adhesions, and sharp edges of the defect. التلاتة دول هم المين فاكتورز فور اوكرانس اوف كومبليكيشنز، بداية من الريديوسابيليتي ونهاية بالسترانجوليشن. كلينيكال بيكتشر: سوبرا امبيليكال ميد لاين سويلينج جيفينج ان اكسبانسايل امبلس اون كوفينج، تيز انكمبليتلي ريديوسابل. If completely reducible, the edges of the defect can be palpable as sharp defect. It is painless unless complicated. Treatment: surgery is the only line of treatment. Truss is inadvisable as the hernia is often irreducible. Truss can be used كان شرط أساسي فيه إن الهرنيا لازم تبقى reducible. فلو كانت irreducible in such cases, it will be more liable for strangulation. Surgical treatment: small defects are repaired with Mayo's repair. In this repair, an elliptical skin incision over the dome of the hernia. Skin flaps are created and dissected up and down. The sac is identified and dissected till its neck, which is known by the glistening white fibers of the linea alba. The sac is opened at the neck. The contents are reduced after division of the adhesions. The sac is excised. The defect is enlarged on both sides till the red fibers of the recti appear. 3 to 5 mattress sutures are inserted so as to overlap the upper over the lower edge. The remaining free edge is sutured to the front of the rectus sheath. A subcutaneous drain is inserted to be removed after 48 hours. Stitches are removed after 7 to 10 days. An abdominal binder is applied for 3 months. Large defects with weak muscles and recurrent hernias also. The main line of treatment is hernioplasty. A diagram showing the details of Mayo's repair for para-umbilical hernia. Next type of abdominal wall hernias is epigastric hernia and fatty hernia of linea alba. بنشرحهم دايما مع بعض لانها دايما متلازمين. All stages بتبقى الاول fatty hernia of linea alba and then بيبقى المسمى بتاعها epigastric hernia when it acquires a sac. Incidence common in adult males and females. Pathology: protrusion of alveoli of extraperitoneal fat through a defect in the interlacing fibers of the linea alba. It may be single or multiple. It has no sac in case of fatty hernia of linea alba. When it enlarges, it may have a small conical one with a piece of omentum as contents, changing the name of it into epigastric hernia. The coverings are skin and subcutaneous tissue. Complications are rare. Clinical picture: a midline supraumbilical small sized swelling, occasionally tender, gives an expansile impulse on coughing. It is rarely reducible. The piece of omentum included within the hernia may pull on the stomach, giving rise to dyspeptic symptoms, very much simulating a peptic ulcer. This is a diagram shows fatty hernia of linea alba. Treatment: small hernia with no sac, treated with excision of the fat lobule and repair of the defect in the linea alba, anatomical repair I mean. Large hernias is repaired with maze operation, which is done as for paraumbilical hernia, but it is a vertical Mayo rather than transverse Mayo repair, which is called with recurrence as it is repair under tension. So better to do hernioplasty, especially if the defect size more than 5 cm. Next type of abdominal wall hernias is divarication of recti. It occurs in babies above the umbilicus. It is self-limited with development of baby. In adults, is very common in Egypt with association with hepatosplenomegaly, also common in multiparous females. Pathology: linea alba is stretched into a weak white fibrous sheath with the recti separated and attenuated. Clinical picture: on straining, a bulge appears between the recti. The gap is felt by the examining fingers when the abdomen relaxes. Treatment: babies are treated with an abdominal belt as the condition is self-limited. Old friable patients with abdominal corset. Fit adults, you have to correct the cause of first, the cause of hernia or the predisposing factor first. Precipitating factor is relieved first, then operation in the form of vertical Mayo repair using a longitudinal incision. The widened linea alba and the peritoneum are opened longitudinally in the midline. Then the two sides are overlapped by matrix sutures and the skin is closed with a drain. Another line of treatment is keel's repair. Indications: it is indicated that all hernias of the middle line with wide neck, reducible contents, and the sac is not liquidated. Using a longitudinal incision, the protonium is identified and dissected down to the neck without opening of the sac. It is pushed back in the abdomen, and by a series of inverting sutures, the edges of the defect are closed. When viewed in cross-section, this repair looks like a keels of the boat, so the name keels repair. This is a diagram showing the hernia bulges through the defect in between the recti. It is inverted into the peritoneal cavity and kept with a series of sutures, rendering the shape of the sac looking like the keel of a boat. Spigelian hernia. This is a hernial protrusion through the abinosis of the transversus abdominis muscle, which is known as the spigelian fascia, which forms the lateral border of the rectus sheath, known as the linea semilunaris. The sac lies deep to the external oblique abinosis, and so it often remains unnoticed until strangulation occurs. Treatment should consist of early operation, since strangulation is a common complication. Next type of abdominal wall hernias is incisional hernia. It is a hernial protrusion through the postoperative scar, which may be due to preoperative causes, poor general condition due to old age, malnutrition, or malignant disease, weak abdominal musculature due to debility or repeated pregnancies, high intra-abdominal pressure due to obesity, chronic cough or straining. Second, faulty operative technique, like division of muscles, injury of nerves, or inadequate suturing. Third, post-operative causes, post-operative distension, coughing or straining. Wound complications like hematoma, infection, and burst abdomen, or hard convalescence without adequate support to the wound. Clinical picture. The hernia usually appears within a few weeks or months after operation, and may affect the whole or part of the scar. Usually starts at the lower end of the scar. It is often steadily increases in size and may strangulate. Treatment: if operation is contraindicated because of old age, excessive obesity, or poor general condition, an abdominal belt may be used. واتكلمنا قبل كده على misconduct in understanding of this line of treatment nowadays. It has no place. In all other cases, operation should always be advised, particularly when the hernia is large and situated in the lower abdomen, depending on the size of the defect, four methods of repair are available. Our line of repair is anatomical reconstruction. It is employed if the defect is small. After removal of the sac, all scar tissue is excised. Don't rely on fibrous tissue in repair, and the layers of the abdominal wall are defined and approximated separately. Keel's repair has a place also in these cases. بكل indications اللي احنا قلنا عليها او الشروط اللي احنا قلنا عليها لازم تكون متوفرة. It is adequate for vertical incisional hernia. The technique is the same as divarication of recti. The third line of operative treatment is Cattle's 5-layer repair. It is a simple and effective method starting within the opened sac. So, أول حاجة بنفتح الساك. It visualizes the contents, reduction of the contents, then the peritoneum and the underlying fibrous edge of the defect are approximated with a continuous interlocking suture of strong compensated cut gut. دي هي أول layer. The sac is then excised 2 cm distal to the suture and the suture and its cut edges are united with a continuous cut gut. Second layer. Then an elliptical incision is made 2 cm lateral to the previous suture line and medial flaps are approximated together. This is the third layer. The muscles on either side are now drawn together with interrupted stitches and then the lateral abinotic flaps are united over the muscles with non-absorbable sutures. This is the fifth layer of repair. A diagram showing Cattle's 5-layer repair. The fourth line of treatment is hernioplasty by a prosthetic mesh. Skin grafting or metallic transplant may be necessary when the defect is very wide. The sites of implantation of mesh are either inlay in between the edges, onlay overlying the defect, and sublay or properitoneal or retromuscular, or the fourth site for implantation is underlay directly over the viscera and done always laparoscopically. نتكلم دلوقتي على الرير ابدومينال هيرنياز، واول مثال لها هو اللامبر هيرنيا. This is a hernial protrusion through petite triangle which is bounded below by the iliac crest laterally by the external oblique muscle and medially by latissimus dorsi. The hernia forms a soft reducible swelling which has to be differentiated from a lumbar abscess and liboma. Treatment, the hernia can be controlled by belt, but if large or causing symptoms, operative repair by suturing or hernioplasty may be carried out. تاني نوع هو الأوبتريتور هيرنيا, which is very rare and most patients are elderly females. The sac passes through the obturator foramen to lie between the obturator externus and pectineus superficial to the obturator vessels. It usually forms no external swelling and is often overlooked until strangulation occurs and the abdomen is explored. Treatment is by transabdominal repair. After reduction of the contents, the sac is excised and the obturator canal is obliterated by sutures. تالت نوع من الرير ابدومينال هيرنياز is gluteal and sciatic hernias. Gluteal hernia protrudes through the greater sciatic notch and sciatic hernia through the lesser sciatic notch. They may form a palpable swelling which should be differentiated from gluteal liboma, aneurysm, or cold abscess. More often, they remain unnoticed until discovered at laparotomy for intestinal obstruction. Treatment is by transabdominal repair. The fourth type is pelvic hernias. These rare hernias may protrude through the pelvic floor at the pouch of Douglas, which is known as median pelvic hernia, or at the foramen of Schwalbe, which is a gap in the line of the origin of the levator inii from the obturator fascia, which is known as the lateral pelvic hernia. Treatment is by transabdominal repair. The fifth type is diaphragmatic hernias. These hernias may protrude through congenital, anatomical, traumatic, or pathological defects in the diaphragm. The most important variety is esophageal hiatus hernia. Treatment: the lobe is untwisted and the causative lesion is dealt with. If the gut is non-viable, resection and anastomosis is carried out. نتكلم الوقت على الـ internal hernias which may occur through bands which usually arise by stretching and metamorphosis of fibrous adhesions. They may be peritoneal, omental, or visceral and may make arches which the bowel prolapses, through which the bowel prolapses, or may form snares which trap or lasso a loop of the gut. أو من خلال peritoneal holes, a loop of bowel may herniate through a hole in the mesentery, in the mesocolon, mesosigmoid, great omentum, gastrohepatic omentum, falciform ligament, or broad ligament of the uterus. أو من خلال bilateral foramina. It may occur through the foramen of Winslow, obturator foramen, or diaphragmatic foramina. أو من موجودة في الريتروبريتونيال فصة. وهي عبارة عن فصي related to the duodenum, cecum, or sigmoid. An operative photo showing a single fibrous band causing bowel obstruction. Another operative photo showing broad-based adhesion identified as an etiology for intestinal obstruction. The duodenal fossae are 5 in number. أولهم the paraduodenal fossa, which lies to the right of the duodenogenital flexure and opens to the right with the inferior mesenteric vein ascending in its free margin. مشابه لها المزنتيريكو برايات الفصة, which lies behind the root of the mesentery and superior mesenteric vessels, and its mouth opens to the left. The third one is the superior duodenal fossa, opens downward and lies behind the transverse fold, which extends from the duodenogenital flexure to the inferior mesenteric vein. The fourth is the inferior duodenal fossa, opens upward and lies behind a similar fold, which extends at a lower level than that of the previous. The fifth one is the retroduodenal fossa, extends behind the third part of the duodenum and its mouth opens downwards. The paracecal fossae are 3 in number. The first is superior iliocecal fossa, which lies behind the superior iliocecal fold, which is a vascular fold of the cecum, which contains the iliocecal vessels. The inferior iliocecal fossa lies behind the inferior iliocecal fold, which is the bloodless fold of Treves. The third is the retrocecal fossa lies behind the cecum and ascending colon. The third is intersigmoid fossa, and this fossa extends upwards and to the right behind the